and just leave it the way it is. You have broad minds, you have newness, you have a new way of thinking. Bring newness to your ministry so that you challenge the superiors, we can do this better. This apostle can take this direction, not just go and fit into the system without reevaluating that ministry, without bringing newness. God has called you to inject newness to this congregation. Not just come and follow the script, what you found. But you don't do it with force. You do it in a creative way. You say, Father, I think this apostolate, as I look at it, it could be benefit more with this. You can even suggest the closure of some apostolates, which are no longer viable. Not that I was sent, I'm obeying, I'm doing. It is important that you bring newness to apostolate as a new younger person. You bring, we call it new wine and new wine skins. Not just the way Father Saul did it 10 years ago. You come here, you are less than 30 years, you are still doing it the same way, because that is how it is supposed to be done. We must reevaluate our apostolic endeavors as young people, because tomorrow, these people who did it 10 years ago are no longer there. You are the ones that are sustaining the message. So if you didn't challenge it now, you didn't challenge the structures, the goals of a particular apostolate. Is not about the success. It is about the fruitfulness. Fruitfulness means, is this thing going to benefit humanity 20 years from now? Yeah. I can't be teaching in a school. Everybody passes my subject with A. But am I throwing to the society well-disciplined, all-rounded human beings that can face challenges? They have the A's, but the girl, the truck driver they meet, they are ready to sleep with them. Can I call my apostolates fruitful?
No.
No. It was just success because of the grace, isn't it? But the person I'm giving to the society, God is very angry with me or very disappointed in me as a religious. Yeah. So we always must differentiate the success and fruitfulness of apostolate. And that's how we evaluate it. It will disappoint me that you have been given an apostolate the way Father Saul did it 20 years ago. You follow it religiously. That means you are not creating, that means you are not bringing in it newness. Yes.
Can I, okay. It's good that you brought this idea, I mean, topic on apostolate and all that.
Yes.
And we have spoken that when you are given a certain apostolate, try to bring newness.
Yes.
Like something that may help, I mean, the people that you are dealing with, the people that you are serving. But you see, learn is we are.
Yeah.
Okay. Of course, we are given apostolate, but we are under someone.
Yes.
Screen and out.
Yes.
Okay. And then when you are sent there, of course, you are a young person and you don't know this. But for example, what we can do for them. But now, you realize that at the end of the day,
yeah.
You have ideas and you present them to your superior.
Yeah.
But you do not, please. Do as we have to bring it.
Yes.
No change here. So you see, sometimes also the superiors, they need education on this, but they need also to give the chance to the young generation to bring newness in their apostolate. Otherwise, we can have so many things to do, but at the end of the day, they don't come out because there is a problem somewhere. There is a blockage, I mean, something like that.
Okay, thank you for that observation. I know what I'm talking about is like it is a straight line, but there are so many other dynamics around newness and innovation. What I mean is, there is also a gentle way. You can also find a gentle way of pushing in your agendas. Sometimes as young people might be very enthusiastic, and change might not come as fast as we think. But what I'm trying to say is that, don't you go back to the apostolate, that sister told us, let's change everything. No. It is a kind of evaluation. It's a kind of, for me, I think, you've expressed your ideas, and you are open to say, I said it, isn't it? Yeah, and I'm not going to stop doing it. I expressed my opinion about it, okay? And my bottom line is, we have to renew ourselves. That's what we call renewal, okay? Because even new people will be old in a few years.
Yes.
You will be old.
Zigo.
How open are you to the ideas of the younger people? Okay? Yeah. Then, today the church is emphasizing on the sense of collaboration. The spirituality and charism of the Don Boscos will benefit more if it becomes in contact with another spirituality. Look at Pope Francis. He's a Jesuit who lived all his life in the Ignatian spirituality. But he has adopted his pontificate to a Franciscan model of manner of proceeding, isn't it?
Yes.
That means he has matured in his own spirituality, now is enriching it with another spirituality. So we don't only collaborate in works. Let us see what can we gain from other spiritualities and other charisms. That is another approach of apostolate. Synodality, listening to the other person. Okay. Our mission, the yardstick of our mission, is it promoting a world in which goodness and solidarity founded on fraternal friendship can thrive? Sum total of all we do, is it improving the state of the human person? Sum total. That in my little way, I have improved or I have advanced the goodness and solidarity that is required. Okay. Then we ask ourselves, what is taking my time and energy? Is it the glory? Because sometimes it's not my glory, but it's the glory of my congregation. We did it, we did it, we did it. The glory of congregation becomes greater than the glory of God. Yeah. That when now we fail in one apostolate, we close it because it's not bringing us the Don Bosco glory. You understand?
Mm.
That the evaluation of closing apostolate is that did it bring us glory? Sometimes the glory of God is in a failure, isn't it?
Mm.
Sometimes what has failed is what God has, glory of God comes out, because first it will humble us, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Second, it will tell us we are not all efficient. We can also fail, eh?
Yes.
Yeah. So sometimes it's not too quick to judge. The glory in apostolate can come out of the failure in itself.
Yes.
That will say, hey, let's think different. And sometimes we are about promoting the glory. Let's do better than the Loretos. Let's do. No. We are all co-workers in the vineyard, isn't it?
Yes.
Let the Loretos do their thing, the Don Boscos do their thing, and together we are building the kingdom. You hear this congregation forever benchmarking. Do your thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. What are you benchmarking? If you can draw the ideas from the other person, do your thing. You don't need to have the school uniform of Loreto students for you to think you are working.
Yeah.
You are succeeding wherever. If anything, you are bearing fruit, isn't it? Not so much success, bearing fruit. So I want you to bring the new dimension of apostolate in that sense. Eh?
Yes.
Yeah. Apostolate is about building the kingdom. We must be ready for it, we must renew it, we must evaluate it. It must bring God glory. Okay?
Yes.
Now, we talked of spiritual identity. What makes you Don Bosco and what makes me Loreto? We are religious. The charism. Well, in canon law, it is broader than the charism. What differentiates an institute from the other is broader than the charism. In fact, the code of canon law, not even one page talks about charism. Nowhere. This is what makes you different from another institute. And when people don't know their identity, they start copying neighbors, isn't it?
Mm.
They think, oh, they have opened an M-Pesa. They are getting money, let's open an M-Pesa. There's something that your founder left. Do it and expand it. Don't come and superimpose your neighbor's spirituality and the rest. So, a clear understanding of the spiritual patrimony will make you abide, will make you be faithful. So the spiritual patrimony has six elements. Number one, the intention of the founder. Your founder, what was his vision? Okay. What did he want to be accomplished exactly? By what kind of people?
Mm.
You get it?
Yes.
The founder, what did he want? Let's say the founder wanted those, I don't know what your founder wanted.
Mm.
Don't know empowerment of the young people.
Something yeah. Like that.
So what kind of persons can fulfill that vision? Yeah? People who are passionate towards the young people, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. So you are going to bring in the congregation all the men of already,
oh,
as postulers, thinking they are going to be enthusiastic about young people. No. People who have special interest on the young people are the people maybe your founder would have wanted.
Huh? Yes.
Creative minds, people with ideas, people who are in touch with the world. Okay. So for example, let's say in Kenya in the recent years we had post-election violence and we had so many people internally displaced. Mm. Kenyans, you remember that, isn't it?
Yeah.
So let's say somebody had an inspiration from the spirit that I want to start a congregation of resettling the IDPs, isn't it?
Mm.
Yes, they start a congregation, the charism is settling the
IDPs.
Then a campaign comes and Ruto and Uhuru, they settle all their IDPs to get votes. So is the congregation to die?
It will die.
What is to happen to the congregation?
It will go die.
The mission is over.
The mission is over. But the spirit,
they can change the hearts.
At the bottom line of that inspiration was, I want to alleviate the suffering of my neighbor, isn't it?
Yes.
That is the bottom. It's not the IDPs, isn't it? Now that this suffering has been alleviated, it took the form of IDPs. Is suffering on the world finished?
No. It is still there.
So then, the founder's vision finds expression from one generation to
another.
You cannot close the congregation because IDPs are settled.
Yeah.
People are still suffering. Eh?
Yeah.
It takes another direction, isn't it?
Yes.
And what kind of people did this man want, the one who started, who would start the congregation for IDPs? What kind of people would be in the congregation?
Humanitarian.
Eh?
Those people who have humanitarian interests.
People who have humanitarian interests, what else? You know, the IDPs are people who have faced violence, isn't it?
Mm.
They are people who want people to listen to them forever.
Psychologists.
Isn't it? People who have a big heart, who can listen to their cry. Mm. People who can reconcile, because this one will be living with the one who killed the other one, isn't it?
Killed my neighbor.
So the members of this congregation must be people who are able to bring people together, not anybody else. Huh?
Yes.
So the intention of the founder is normally not just the work, but the qualities of the people to do it. So if Don Boscos are going to take young people who have no passion for the youth, what will happen?
The congregation.
The congregation starts just existing, isn't it? Now, after the intention, listen, another identity is the nature of the institute. I will explain it this way. When you open a school, it is registered by the government, isn't it? How is it registered?
By how is it doing?
You will go and say we are opening a boys' day school.
Mm-hmm.
So it is maybe Don Bosco Boys Primary School, isn't it?
Yeah.
That is the name of the school.
Yeah.
That is how the government will register it.
Mm.
Or Don Bosco Mixed Day Primary School.
Mm.
Or Don Bosco Girls Boarding School. So if it is Mixed Day Primary School, and after 2 years, no girl registered in the school, all the students were boys, is it still mixed or not in the eyes of the government?
It is still mixed.
The identity is still mixed, isn't it?
Yes.
So the nature of the institute means what the founder told the church. The registration, the canonical identity. So for Don Bosco it is a clerical religious apostolic institute, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. So it is the licensing that has been approved. So the institute can be secular or religious, contemplative, active, lay or clerical, as it is approved, and you cannot change that. You cannot change that. Because at the end of my explanation, you are going to describe yourself to me.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes. You will tell me the intention, the nature, the purpose. Why do you exist? Why do you exist? So, if you are asked today, why are you still relevant? What purpose are you serving in the world? This is now the ongoing unfolding of the charism, the purpose of the institute, isn't it?
Mm.
So, if the institute starts forming young people, but not according to their to the purpose of the institute. The institute is supposed to empower the youth, but now the congregation is, the institute is forming young people to go and I don't know what, to go and work in hospitals. The institute is not serving its purpose, isn't it?
Yes.
According to the intention of the
founder.
The founder. So, the correct understanding of the purpose helps to protect the mission, because people will start bringing in things that are alien to what the founder wanted. Then the spirit of the spirituality, isn't it?
Mm.
So the spirit is the specific modality in which you tell the world about Christ. The specific modality in which you communicate to the world about
Christ.
Some people communicate the healing Christ. Some people communicate the merciful Christ. Some people
Christ.
Communicate
redeeming Christ.
Redeeming Christ. Redeeming Christ. The compassionate Christ. The manner in which a particular religious institute communicates the nature of Christ to the people.
Suffering Christ.
Okay? Yeah, I don't know how you do it.
Eucharistic.
You are Eucharistic Christ.
Yes.
But Eucharist, I think, anyway. That's your spirituality. Your spirituality is?
Okay.
Okay. I don't know whether that is merciful Christ or the care of the loving Christ. Or
compassionate Christ.
Compassionate Christ, isn't
yes,
it?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so always remember, spirituality is the mode or the modality through which as a group, we communicate the nature of Christ to the world.
Yes.
In what we do and how we live.
Yes.
Number four, the character.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. So when people meet you at your apostolic institute, how are you carrying out that intention of the founder? Some people are carrying out the intention by being contemplative. You know the monastics, eh?
Yes.
Their nature is praying, eh? But you and I, our nature is apostolic, isn't it?
Yes.
So the nature of the institute can be conventual. Conventual, this was in between.
Wow.
They are contemplative and they are also
active.
Apostolic.
Apostolic.
Then we have the monastic, people who are totally monastic. They are enclosed, or apostolic in character. Yeah. So what happens when an apostolic congregation decides to be monastic?
We change the
apostolic means you have apostles, isn't it?
Yes.
So, this group, because they are supposed to be out working, they are back to the community.
Pray.
For devotion, adoration, angelus. Apostolate is suffering, isn't it?
Yes.
Then it's our traditions. Huh?
Mm.
Each founder has left the institute with some traditions. Huh?
Yes.
You have your own traditions that are different from my own. Huh?
Yes.
For example, you may have some kind of practices that is uniquely for Don Bosco families, isn't it?
Yes.
You don't go and find them in other congregations.
Yes.
Yeah. There would have been pious practices of the founders of the earlier members, and they've been carried from one generation to
another.
But they have to be evaluated. Are they still sound?
Yes.
Because some of the institutes, one of the practices was every Friday, the spirit would beat everybody, whip. With the members to remember how Jesus died.
Come with me.
Is that a sound tradition?
He was
beaten before he became superior.
Come with me.
I don't know who is the first one. Or let me give you a practical one. Let me give you a practical example. Mm. Let's say in the beginning the Don Boscos were few. Maybe they were less than 10. The founder and a few members, isn't it?
Yes.
So they used to do everything together. The founder was older than everybody. So the founder is the one who used to lock the gate, because he was the superior, lock all the doors, switch off the light, open the tabernacle for adoration, and keep all the keys in his room. Because naturally he was the eldest, and everybody found him there, so he knew the compound. Generation, it becomes the tradition that it is only the superior to lock the gate. And the superior to switch off the lights, and the superior to expose the blessed sacrament. Then with the time the superior has dementia, isn't it? He cannot remember where the key of the tabernacle is.
Give up.
Or the superior is now an invalid, is incapacitated in the wheelchair. So the novice, there's a novice assigned to bring the superior to the door, lift him up to stand there, because it's only the spirit to open the door and lock it. Eh? Is that a sound tradition?
No.
And you know the story of the monk and the cat? Eh?
Which one? No, no.
Yeah.
Some people know the story of the monk and the cat. It's an example of sound tradition.
Yeah.
How many people know it?
Only him.
Okay, let me repeat it. In this monastery, I'm talking about sound tradition. Eh?
Yes.
There was a cat. The cat belonged to the community. So when people are having evening prayers, the monks, the cat will be going around with their legs and distracting them when they are praying. Eh? Then one monk said, "Why don't we tie the cat to the chair of the abbot? Because the rest had very low stools, which had no whatever. So they would tie, it's the abbot that had a good chair, so they would tie the cat to the chair of the abbot. So before prayer, you look for the cat, you tie the cat, then people begin praying. So it became a ritual. The cat would be playing and chasing rats at the fence, but one monk has to run. Go and collect. You know, the cat will not even come to the prayer. It never used to come every day anyway. But you go and collect the cat to come and tie on the chair of the abbot. Then the cat died. One time the cat died. Then the monk, how will we pray now? They went to the market to buy another cat. Now they have to tie the cat.
Then they pray.
The chair, he goes to the
essence.
Then the abbot also died. One time the abbot died. Then they said, but how will we tie the cat and the abbot is not there? Huh? Let's keep the cat in his room until we elect another
abbot.
Because we cannot pray without the abbot and the cat together. You see how something simple turned into a very kind of stupid tradition, isn't it?
Good.
Yeah. So, okay, I just wanted to say, it's important that we know our spiritual identity. Maybe you know it already.
Yes.
But in this way, it is very, very important to know the intention of the founder. What he wanted to do and the qualities of men to do it. If the congregation is for healthcare, what kind of members are supposed to join it?
Doctors.
People, not just doctors,
qualified
people
medics.
Who have compassion to the sick,
yes.
People who can see blood, people who can put the head of somebody knocked by the vehicle together without screaming and running away. People who can carry a dead body for 7 hours from one point to another. If you can't, don't go there. That's the wrong congregation for you. People who are moved to help somebody in distress, somebody who is sick. People who can live with blood. They see the blood, the
come
person
on.
From the accident, they're able to wipe it like this. And they are not traumatized, they're just going to sleep well.
Nice.
My brother, you are not called to such a congregation. That's why charismatic gives a ticket. There are people who are dying to go and do that. They can't wait to grow up to go and do that. Because that is where God has called them. So it is also important in vocation promotion to know what is the intention of our founder and what kind of people. Because then, if we are medical and we take people who cannot see a sick person without fainting, then we have 100 of them. Who is going to carry the hospital? Carry on the hospital.
No.
Then the nature of the institute. The nature of the institute will allow us to exist in the church with our identity.
Mm.
Yeah, with our identity. It's our official recognition in the church.
Mm.
Then the purpose. Wow. We keep on renewing this every time.
Wow.
Yeah, because sometimes people say, we don't have money in this congregation. You open M-Pesa, we are going to open public toilets in the city so that people can pay money. Sisters, you cook mandasis. Sisters, you do this. People going to things that were never the intention of the founder. That's why you see But you have founded to help the poor. Now they have huge, huge schools. Here we have to be, do this. There are works that we acquire, but there are works proper to the institute.
Yes.
So if now all the institutions have no young people, are the youth are no longer there, you ask yourself, that are we, where is the wind taking us? If originally we were for the youth, and now not even a single institution in Nairobi, you will find this disadvantaged youth. We are building big schools, we are building universities, are we still faithful to our purpose? And this is how we evaluate our apostolate. Where is our energy going? Then the spirituality. The spirituality is very important. That's how we also pray.
Mm.
The character. Yeah. The character really helps us in our way of life.
Yes.
People pooping their neighbor, now they are praying 24 hours and the apostolate is suffering. And then they think, oh, us, we are very holy. Even the young people who are very apostolic, they think they are in the wrong place. And those are the ones in the right place. Because the institute is apostolic in character, isn't it?
Mm.
Yeah, not that we don't pray. We pray, but we remember we are apostolic in
nature.
We are not Benedictines. Yeah. Then, South traditions. Some people regain even very terrible traditions that are not even helpful to the community.
Mm-hmm.
So they have to be evaluated from time to time.
Yes.
Then I want to go to spiritual life, which is very, very important for young people. Then we will have at least some questions and some discussions, okay?
Yes.
Now, our life, as we all know, cannot go on without being sustained by prayer, isn't it? We can do mighty things, but if we don't have friendship with God, we will not survive. That's what I can tell you for a fact. My 25 years, I'm talking from experience.
Yes.
Without daily laboring to be in union with God, we will not survive.
Vanity.
We'll be like the tree that was given to Jonah as the shade.
Mm-hmm.
It will bloom for a while. But without tapping from God, it will not survive. Eh? It's not just fidelity to prayer, but vigilance. Be very vigilant on what takes you away from God. Eh?
Mm-hmm.
Even if you know the methods I've given, just listen to them again.
That's good.
How do we become vigilant? How is Satan drawing us away from God? We have to be very careful about this. Satan behaves in our soul like a spoiled child. Eh?
Yeah.
I want it. Give it to me. Eh? I want it. That it works on our desires. You remember, life is about desire, riches, and?
Power. Power.
Hmm?
Power, desire, and riches. Oh my.
It is power, desire,
or riches.
And riches, isn't it? Yeah. That is where Satan comes. Wants us to acquire. Just acquire but don't tell anybody. Isn't it?
Yeah.
So normally desires are good, but when the devil comes to take control of them, we want them there. Now. I see the advertisement on the phone, I'm going for it. Isn't it?
Yeah.
I have my money. After all, I'm not going to steal from anybody. But it becomes a crippling habit in our spiritual growth. That I want to satisfy every desire, every appetite that I have. And sometimes the devil takes us step by step. It becomes a very unhealthy desire, selfish, and sometimes immoral. Imagine a young person came to you this morning. They have not eaten with their fellow siblings who are orphans, three of them, and you have 2,000 shillings in your pocket. And because I have to go and buy that shoe I saw in town, cannot. Yeah. So I even become selfish because the devil has said, you are a religious. Where do you get money to give people? You go and buy your shoe. So that is how the devil works with our desires. You get it?
Yeah.
He puts, he brings the temptation so nicely. You know the way he brought it to Eve at the garden? The fruit was, I can imagine Eve was salivating, isn't it?
Mm.
This fruit is too nice. You've seen the advert of beer,
yes.
The way it pours in the glass. The sound of Coca-Cola, the way she goes through the glass. When they're advertising, isn't it? That's how the devil works. Yeah? After that, you just go and grab one, isn't it?
Jackie.
So, we have to be aware Like that is how the devil works in our spiritual progress, okay? It cripples us into this temptation of fulfilling our desires and goes and says, ah, don't pray now, just look at this in the computer. Yeah. Whatever you desire, it is so nice, you know, they will remove it from the internet. Check, check now. So the devil cripples us that way. He works with our natural desires and makes us slaves of it. Okay? And this can really cripple our spiritual growth. Because now we develop in selfishness and sometimes we satisfy immoral desires, isn't it? Yeah. It will start with the desire of food, desire of beer, desire of women, or desire of power. It will take us far. That is how the devil starts. So as young religious, be careful of this.
Yeah.
Okay. So that is one way of being vigilant for spiritual power. Okay?
Yes.
It's not enough to pray, it's also enough to check how the devil working with me. Okay,
we
go to the next one.
Satan
has a false lover. Will pretend to be your friend. There are some friends like that, eh? Then you don't even bother. Yeah, don't even try to pray. You don't even pray. You need so badly, you will not change. Entertains you in secret, isn't it? Yeah. Yeah, entertains you in secret and inflict yourself with doubts, despair, you will not make it, don't even bother. Yeah, so like you've been trying to labor with, I'm not very faithful with my meditation, don't worry. You did meditate yesterday, nothing happened. Yeah, okay. So, really can remind you, you remember how you failed last year, what progress are you going to make? Right? So, entertains you, tries to, in secret, this lover is trying to keep you in secret. Don't make progress. You are okay the way you are. We are together. I'm with you. Okay? It's like a secret friend I want to go and visit without the community knowing. Okay? The friend is busy taking me away from the congregation, but the friend couldn't tell anybody. Don't tell anybody. Okay? So, the Satan will always remind you with the feelings of discouragement, feelings of despair, feelings of helpless. Don't, you will not make it. Who tells you will make it this time? Don't even make progress. Okay? And don't tell anybody. So he will help you to appear very normal out there, that you are doing well, but inside, in secret, the devil has already got you. Yeah. Just pretend you're going to the chapel. They don't know. You are doing well. Yeah. The only way to succeed is to bring, expose it to the open. Are we listening? Once you expose the devil, it will lose the power. Satan is acting like an army commander. An army commander will strategize your weakest and strongest points. The enemy will prepare it, but carefully studies your weakest point, where you're most vulnerable, and then attacks. Isn't it? Yeah. So, for example, yeah, I feel I'm a generous person in the community, I'm available. That is my good gift, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. So, I am helping people, I am a very, very generous person, and then with the time, my generosity gains popularity and glory, because others feel good I'm helping them. Eh?
Yes.
Others feel good I'm able to help them. So by and by, I turn into, I'm good because I'm the most generous. I'm not as unkind as brother so and so, isn't it? Look at me, what generosity come to me. So I started feeling proud and making people to need me. Come, I'm the one going to help you. And I even cripple anybody trying to be generous in the community. I'm the one who runs to God and help, isn't it? Now, my good point has become my weakest point, isn't it?
Yeah.
You see how the devil has turned a good thing into a bad thing? Yeah, so it is now pride and arrogance. So what was good, now the devil succeeds in winning and finding my weakest point. Eh?
Yes.
And I will not know. And that time they ask another person to do the thing and not me. Why did they leave me and I'm the generous?
By the way.
Why did the superior ignore me? This is how the devil works. The devil is not going to tell me to go and sleep, go and sleep with the woman. Mm. He knows he will not do it. Those are too direct.
Yeah.
He will come inside your good things and turn them to your weakest point.
Sure.
Yeah. And you think you are still praying.
The devil is a
liar. It's a liar.
She can't buy herself.
Okay, now it's proper liar. Coming as the angel of
light. Yeah, mama.
Brings very good holy thoughts in your mind. For example, I've said, I like adoration, I like prayer. For the pandemic of COVID, I'm going to do adoration 3 times in this day. Is it not a good thing to pray for those who have been infected with COVID at the end of COVID?
Yes.
Yeah. So I begin my adoration 3 hours each day. I have no time for community prayer because I am praying for the end of COVID. If anything, I'm the one doing adoration in the community. I start looking at the rest. These ones do not even want to commit to end. They are not praying enough like me. Okay?
Mm.
Yeah. And I start feeling bitter and judgmental towards the rest. The way we have the pandemic, people are not even bothered.
Huh?
Yeah. And then when we have community prayer, I pray loudly for COVID. God, remember to help those who have COVID. Because nobody else cares. I'm the one who cares for people. I'm not praying sincerely, but I'm reminding you, I'm the only one praying for COVID. Yeah. God, bring this pandemic to an end. This is how the devil works, my brothers. This is how the devil works. Bring holy thoughts in you, and do you think you are still praying?
Oh.
You are talking not to sincerely but to attack others. Look, I'm the only one who is praying for COVID in this community. That's anything I do adoration 3 times
a day.
That's yeah. So these holy thoughts are actually the tricks of the enemy, hidden in evil intentions and deceit.
Sister.
Yes?
Now, sorry to cut you short.
Yes.
Now, in that way, shall we really see heavens? No, because it's true. No, yeah, it's true because you know when let's say a priest is preaching.
Yes.
And he preaches, and he, of course he's gifted. He preaches very well,
yeah.
But he goes out and says, "I think that I'm the only one who can preach here." Let's see. That's pride already. Right?
So, the thing is, my brother, this is me. Forget about the priest. We know ourselves.
Yeah.
We know ourselves.
Yes.
Yeah. This one, I am giving you my own tip because I use it for my own self.
Yeah.
Life is offering so many opportunities for pride, for judgment. You can do it in community all the time.
Yes.
But I come back. Because I know it is okay to come and give you a description or an explanation in prayer. But what is going to sustain a young religious and all of us is to be vigilant on how the devil pulls us away from our relationship with God. This person is praying at all in 3 times a day. But is the person praying?
No.
The person is serving the devil and his intentions.
You do not cast all the day.
When we say we are not joking, is it? Yeah. When the devil is attacking like an army commander, is it? The devil is not going to come to you with open thing to do. The devil is going to pass through your weak points. Okay? Yeah.
So now, my question was, as you said, the devil can bring good thoughts in a very fun way.
Yes.
Thinking that you are doing wait, Magone.
Yes.
Hello. Thinking
now,
that.
No, seriously, can we be a little bit reflective?
Yeah. So thinking that you, as a person, you think that you are doing the best thing or a good thing.
Yeah.
Okay. But the devil has used that as a channel to
draw you away.
To trap you, of course.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
To draw you away. Like let's say. You are doing, of course, your intention is very good.
Yes.
But the, let's say, outcome, your intention of adoring for the sake of ending COVID is very good.
Yeah.
But the manner in which you are doing is setting a trap for them.
Yeah.
Now, that's why I was asking, shall we really see heaven? Because we are trapped by the devil, but sometimes we are not aware.
That is why we see the outcome. Is it judgmental? Is it bitterness? What feelings do you have? And even you, my brother. Adoration that takes you away from the program of the community. To start looking at people that they are not praying for COVID the way I'm doing. Already that will tell you this thing is not from the from God.
Yeah.
This thing is from the evil one. Yeah. And if at prayer you just continuously have doubts, despair, anxieties, it means the devil does not want you to progress in, because spiritual life is about consolation, hope, you know, better way, positivity, isn't it? So if in prayer, all the time you are afflicted, you will not make it. You are not as good in prayer. You are a sinner. God forgives our sins, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. So this, which is this prayer that you can never even feel good once. And it goes on for months and months and months. It's not from the good spirit. That is from the devil. Trying to take you away from the mercy and goodness of God, isn't it?
Yes.
And you have to expose the devil, either in confession or in spiritual direction, that I'm feeling this and I don't think this is from the good spirit.
Sister.
Yes?
I could be something maybe.
Yes.
We are attributing a lot.
Yes.
To the devil.
Yeah.
But you know, human person is a human person. Human persons are not perfect and all that. Was I attaching anything to the devil? What about the devil? That human person, something like that, I can do like this. But I should not say that. And then the devil has done this. The devil has. No, there are many groups from the devil.
Okay. Yeah, I get what you mean. Why I was using the example of the devil, I understand what you mean is that in our heart, we have the two spirits. Let me say that. The spirit from, okay, normally as a human being, we have the two opposite spirits within us, isn't it?
Good and bad.
So take it this way. Which one influences my action?
Good and bad spirit.
It's actually yourself. Huh?
Mm.
So maybe we remove the word Satan, but you say the dynamics in my heart. They have tendency to take me away from God or tendency to bring me closer to God. Okay. So, in this, I just gave an example to give it like some kind of image, okay? But really, it is the tension within our soul, so. And sometimes it's purely our own human nature that is continuously in our habits drawing us away from God. So, what I wanted to say is not enough to pray. It's also vigilant. Because the one doing adoration three times a day, even if they went to the superior, they will say, I pray, isn't it?
Mm.
But what is the fruit of their prayer? Bitterness, judgmental, and arrogance are holier than
aggression.
The rest of you. This is a personal journey that I cannot put on my neighbor. And the other spirit is pulling us all the time in whatever direction. But I've just given you the images in which we can identify our spiritual progress. Okay?
Mm.
Yes, neighbor.
Sister, help me to understand.
Yes.
When you say that to be a vigilant, can you explain more about prayer? Most people pray, but when you say you have to be vigilant, what do you mean by this?
Okay. What I mean by vigilant is to be on the outlook.
No.
Check. When I'm praying, what is my motivation? We keep on checking with ourselves. Huh?
Mm.
It's like we know that there are things around here, huh? Mm. That as we are inside here, somebody can come and take one car. So we keep on throwing our eyes out, isn't it?
Yes.
That is what I mean by
vigilant.
Being vigilant. Eh? I don't just engross myself as I'm doing when I'm okay, I'm praying, but I'm always checking with myself. When I'm praying, after my prayer, what happens? Does my prayer now make me judge my brothers or make me feel like I am so old? That is what vigilant means. Checking after. Keeping checking. Let me not just settle for the fact that I went for community prayer, I went for apostolate, I went for my personal prayer. What happens in those prayers? Okay? What happens in those prayers? And if you follow this young man, it will take you a long way in your life, right? It will take you a long way, a long, long way. That each time I check, what is motivating me here? So the above are some of the ways we can detect. There are many ways of how we grow away from God. And somebody can be away from God for 10 years or 20, all the rest of their life. They still think they are praying. And they think they are very united with God. That is why you hear another religion has killed another.
Hey, wait.
Isn't it? Yeah.
It's poisoned.
Poisoned another one. Or somebody just got themselves in a big scandal. Because by and by, because the devil does not want you to be exposed. You don't want to be exposed. In the out, they really put a good holy and a good religious. We even admire them, isn't it? But in their private life, that is what is happening. Then you wonder, what happened to so and so? But that has been going on all their life. They allowed desire to take very deep roots. Power to take very deep roots, money to take very deep roots, honor and private and pride to take very deep roots. And if we allow the devil to lead our life, or the other spirit as we call it, not yet the devil, if we lean on the other side, this can go deeper and deeper and deeper over the years. That's why we find religious, if they are not in power, they are not happy, isn't it? If they are not in position, they are not happy. Yeah. So, I urge you to check on your spiritual life. This is the core. This is the core all the time. It may make sense today, but you will one day meet me and tell me. Yeah. So, I finish up and I say, it is the love of God and humanity which propels us to serve. Yes. At the end of it all, it is the love of God and humanity which pushes us every morning to serve. Yeah, it is the force of love. We serve in truth and in deep conviction that our contribution, however small it is, okay? However small we think it is, it goes a long way in making the universe a better
place.
Okay? Like when Neil Armstrong stepped in the moon, somebody said, that one small step for man became one giant leap for mankind. And Mother Teresa says, we know only too well that when we are doing, what we are doing is nothing more than a drop in the ocean. But even a drop in the ocean is a drop more, isn't it?
Mm.
It's a drop more. Okay, so I end there and I welcome reactions and comments. Before I look at the reaction of women. What time is it?
Now it is 12:24.
24:24?
Yes.
Okay, so we have the 6 minutes to respond or to comment or to ask. Yes, my brother.
Thank you. Maybe for me, maybe what I want to elaborate more.
Yes.
What is the difference between spirituality and charism?
Oh, spirituality and charism. Spirituality. The modality with which we communicate Christ to the world. Modality. That is spirituality. Maybe ours is love, another one is mercy, compassion, healing Christ, compassionate Christ. That modality that our founder left. Okay. So the way we live, the way we work, communicates to the world that aspect of Christ. So if it is about compassionate Christ, how do we bring that compassionate Christ to the people we serve and we live? Is it clear?
Yes.
Yeah. And spirituality can be lived by anybody. The charism. The charism is the sum total of the nature the purpose, the character, all that put together. But I want to dial it down to the purpose.
Yes.
The purpose for which the congregation exists. That which makes the congregation to exist. Yeah. You know the core. What was the project? You modified it, you expanded it, you expressed it immediately, but what is it? I gave the example of the IDPs, you remember?
Yes.
This man or woman started a congregation to settle the IDPs. What was inside him or her? He was pushed by compassion to improve the suffering of the neighbor, isn't it? Yeah. He wanted to alleviate the suffering of the
neighbor.
That is the charism, okay? That means so long as there's another neighbor suffering, even with all the IDPs settled, the charism is still alive. It will take different expression, okay?
Yes.
So the charism is not IDPs. The charism is alleviating the suffering of the neighbor moved by the love of Christ, isn't it? Yeah. You get the difference?
Yes.
Any other question?
Okay. We started by Yes. My question is on chastity.
Chastity.
Yes.
Okay.
Is there a requirement for chastity?
Requirement for chastity. Okay. Let me talk of the canonical requirements. Okay. So chastity ultimately is the understanding of what is the role of our sexuality in the salvation mission of Christ. What is the role? The role of sexuality in the salvation mission of Christ.